I haven't in all of my life experienced anything like we have here. Talking about setting my soul on fire, I've already burned out. Thank you, Dr. Bonham, for inviting me to this conference. And I'm going to say again, I've been in a many state evangelism conferences across this nation, but I've never been in one where the messages were so rich and the music was so stirring. I tell you, my bell has been rung. And like I told the state convention a few months ago, if your bell hasn't been rung, your clapper is broken. And if your fire has not been lighted, your wood is wet. I've come to say tonight that Jesus is Lord. I don't have to prove it. He just is. He always has been, is. He is, and he always will be, is. See, you don't keep your verbs in the proper tense when you're talking about him. See, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. From the book of Philippians, second chapter, verses 9, 10, and 11. Wherefore God hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You see, we are forever blowing bubbles, looking for ships that never come in, chasing pots of gold at the end of receding rainbows. Now, when a child blows bubbles, he's not concerned about values. He's thrilled as long as the bubble lasts, and when it bursts, he simply blows another. How do you expect your ships to come in when you've sent no ships out? And you never will find that proverbial pot of gold, because you try to ignore him who has the rainbow wrapped around his shoulder. You remember back during the 60s, the offbeat theologians romped around in their subsurface playpens and emerged and announced that God was dead. Now, that shouldn't have been surprising to us, because the Bible has informed us that the fool had said in his heart, there is no God. And when I first heard that absurd statement, it made me want to ask some stupid and senseless questions like, who assassinated God? What coroner was called? Who signed his death certificate? And who was so well acquainted with the one pronounced dead that he could identify the deceased? In what obituary column did you find his name, and why was I not notified? I'm a member of the family. God is spirit. He does not die by pronouncement. He does not die by assassination. He does not die by denial. He just does not die. He's as real today as he was to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. If you'll trust him, he will be as true to you as he was to Abram when Abram was called to go out not knowing whether he went. If you'll trust him, he will be as evident to you as he was to Moses when God manifested himself in a burning bush. Now, when they couldn't get anywhere with the God is dead idea, now in these 70s, one of the top theological questions is, where did God come from? Now, the primary purpose of God in creation was to prepare moral beings, spiritually and intellectually capable of worshiping him. When heaven and earth were yet unmade, when there was empty blackness and void formlessness and darkness was on the face of the deep, when time was yet unknown, thou in thy bliss and majesty did live and love alone. He called light out of darkness. He called cosmos out of chaos. That is, he called order out of confusion. But the question still clamors for an answer. Where did God come from? And the answer is, he came from nowhere. Now, that's theologically correct and it's biblically sound. For Habakkuk said, I saw him when he left the hills of Teman, the Holy One from Mount Paran. And Teman simply means nothing or nowhere. So he came from nowhere. I made that statement in Detroit some time ago, and a man talked with me after the meeting, and he said, preacher, let's be reasonable about this thing. You up there tonight talking about God came from nowhere. That doesn't make sense. Let's be reasonable about it. I said, all right, if you just want to be reasonable about it, the reason God came from nowhere, there wasn't anywhere for him to come from. And coming from nowhere, he stood on nothing. And the reason he had to stand on nothing, there was nowhere for him to stand. And standing on nothing, he reached out where there was nowhere to reach and caught something when there was nothing to catch and hung something on nothing and told it to stay there. Now, you'll find that in Job 26 and 7, that he hung this world on nothing. And standing on nothing, he took the hammer of his own will, and he struck the anvil of his omnipotence, and sparks flew therefrom. And he caught them on the tips of his fingers, and flung them out into space, and bedecked the heavens with stars. And nobody said a word. The reason nobody said anything, there wasn't anybody there to say anything. So God himself said, that's good. And God has given Christ a name that's above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Now, the hinges of human history have turned by the strength of the insignificant man who has linked his life with the lordship of Christ. Rivers of civilization have cut new courses because of the courage of men who have come under the loving lordship of Jesus. But the question is being asked today, what is in it for us in our kind of a day? Well, for the lost, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For the municipality, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. For the nation, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. For those who claim to be committed, acknowledgement of Christ's authority must be accompanied by absolute obedience to his commandment. Jesus asked, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? There are four classes of men who may be described by their relationship to the Lord. One, those who neither call him Lord nor do the things which he says. Two, those who call him Lord but do not the things which he says. Three, those who do not call him Lord but do the things which he says. Four, those who both call him Lord and do the things which he says. Now, Lord is not a word to be taken upon our lips lightly and glibly and meaninglessly. It is a title which must be taken upon our lips with godly fear. We can see what Jesus meant when he said, not everyone who says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. Everyone is mastered by someone or something. Christ alone deserves first place. We need a strength stronger than ourselves. We need a strength strong enough to help us to stand the stresses and the strains of our struggle. And the rightful Lord of our lives is Jesus Christ. For God has given Christ a name that's above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now these are that words of that man who walked all over the pagan world, turned every house into a chapel and every street corner into a pulpit to proclaim the Lordship of Christ. He lit the lamp of the gospel even in Caesar's household. He disturbed a nest of eagles and sent them screaming across the Roman sky. He honeycombed the land with the Christian church and then sat in Nero's cell in chains and conquered Rome by writing letters. In his letter to the Philippians, Paul penned the arresting announcement that God hath given Christ a name that's above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. In his letter to the Colossians, Paul declared that Jesus has the unqualified supremacy. He is the image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn over all creation. He is the head of the church. He is the firstborn from the dead. In all things, he has the preeminence. He precedes all others in his priority. He exceeds all others in his superiority. And he succeeds all others in his finality. He is the master of the mighty. He's the captain of the conquerors. He's the head of the heroes. He's the leader of the legislators. He's the overseer of the overcomers. He's the governor of governors. He's the prince of princes. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. In his letter To the Romans, Paul declared that we all belong to Christ and are responsible ultimately to Him for everything that we do. We live unto the Lord, and when we die unto the Lord. Yea, the great end for which Christ lived and died and lives for always is that He might be Lord both of the dead and the living. Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, the word Lord means having power or authority. The Great Commission is based on the claims of our Savior's Lordship. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Lord means ownership. He's Lord because He made this house in which we dwell. See, He's the one who walked on the brow of nothing, and with a gesture of His hands, worlds were formed. He scooped out the seas with the palm of His hand, dug deep the gorges, piled up the hills, and propped up the mountains by His will. The moon and stars lean on His arm. He's Lord. He's the owner. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For He hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Now, He didn't have to put His signature in the corner of a sunrise. Nobody else can cause a sun to rise. He's the owner. He didn't have to put a laundry mark in the lapel of a meadow. He's the owner. He didn't have to carve His initials in the side of the mountain. He's the owner. He didn't have to put a brand on the cattle of 1,000 hills. He's the owner. He didn't have to give a copyright on the song that He gives the birds to sing. He's the owner. Beyond the human level, the word Lord stands as a reverent allusion to God. The Orthodox Hebrew in Jesus' day is in our own. Would not even pronounce the name God, Jehovah, or Yahweh. Instead, when he read the sacred and incommunicable name of God, he would simply say, the Lord. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Now, Christians have applied this title to Christ in the latter usage on either the human or divine level. The title Lord is a mark of respect and implied pledge of obedience. Once Simon Peter stood before a hostile crowd and said, God has made that same Jesus whom ye've crucified both Lord and Christ. Now Christ represents the thing that God has done to redeem us. Lord represents what we ought to do because we are redeemed. You know, we ought to call Him Master and be obedient servants to Him. We ought to call Him Owner because He possesses absolutely our lives. In Him we live and move and have our being. We ought to call Him Father and be obedient sons and daughters, for He's our only hope. And He's our only help. God is our refuge and our strength. He's a very present help in trouble. Therefore shall not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come behold the works of the Lord. What desolations he hath made in the earth. He maketh walls to cease unto the ends of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder and burneth the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Jesus is Lord because he came down the stairway of heaven, born in Bethlehem, here in Egypt, brought up in Nazareth, baptized in Jordan, tempted in the wilderness, performed miracles by the roadside. Why, he healed multitudes without medicine and made no charges for his service. He conquered everything that came up against him. He took your sins and mine and went out on the cross and died. While hanging on that cross, Jesus said several things. But when the thief taunted him, if you be the Christ, come down from that cross and save yourself and us. To that taunt, Jesus never said a mumbling word. But the silence seemed to have said, you just wait until Sunday morning, and I'll show you. You just wait until Sunday morning. I'll show you it's better to come up out of a grave than it is to come down from a cross. And he dropped his head in the locks of his shoulder, and he died. Yeah, he really died. Don't pay attention to these fellas talking about a swoon theory. He died. Yes, he did. His friend say he died. Even the enemies say he died. Yes, he died. He died. The veil of the temple was rent in twain. He died. Well, Matthew said the dead got up out of the grave and walked the streets after the resurrection. He died. I'm talking about he died. But I don't like to stay there talking about he died. I like to rush on and say he was buried in Joseph's new tomb. Buried in a borrowed tomb. Now that used to bother me. The one who made everything. The man, one who holds waters in the hollow of his hand. Meets out the heavens with a span. Comprehends the dust and weighs the mountains in the scale and the hill in the balance. One who's rich in houses and land holds the wealth of this world in his hand and being buried in a borrowed tomb. Well, he wasn't going to stay there long, so a borrowed tomb would suffice. Yes! He went down in the grave and cleaned out the grave and made it a pleasant place to wait for the resurrection. And on schedule, he got up with every form of power in the orbit of his omnipotence. He's Lord. You know, men have been waiting. They think maybe his power is going to fail him. Or maybe somebody is going to wrestle his power from him. Somebody is going to destroy his power. If you're going to try to destroy his power, let me ask you something. What are you going to use for power? If you try to destroy him by fire, he'll refuse to burn. If you try to destroy him by water, he'll walk on the water. If you try to destroy him by seal of an empire, he'll break it. If you try to destroy him by law, you'll find no fault in him. If you try to destroy him by strong wind, the tempest will lick his hand and lay down at his feet. If you try to destroy him, yes. If you try to destroy him by putting him in a grave, he'll rise. If you try to destroy him by ignoring him or rejecting him, soon you'll hear a still small voice saying, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If a man will open the door, I'll come in and sup with him and he with me. Jesus is Lord. Yes, he is. Jesus is a pearl from paradise. He's a gem from the glory land. He's truth's fairest jewel, and he's time's choicest theme. He's life's
strongest cord, and he's light's clearest ray. He's purity's whitest peak, and his joy's deepest tide. His name stands as a synonym for free healing, friendly help, and full salvation. His blessed name is like honey to the taste, is like harmony to the ear, is like health to the soul, is like hope to the heart. Yes, he's Lord. He's higher than the heavens of heavens, and he's holier than the holy of holies. In his birth is our significance. In his life is our example. In his cross is our redemption. In his resurrection is our hope. Yes, Jesus is Lord. At his birth, men came from the east, and at his death, men came from the west, and the east and the west met in him. Hallelujah! Jesus Christ is Lord, and he's Lord. He's omnipotent. Yes, the Lord God omnipotent reigneth, and at his name, to his name, in his name, every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess. Don't let it be said too late. Yes, every knee, the white knee, every knee, the black knee, every knee, wounded knee, every knee is going to bow. Every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Well, there are some who are saying, Jesus, I'm saved, but he's not my Lord. If he's not your Lord, you're not saved. He's not going to be Savior our Lord. He's going to be Savior and Lord. And then I hear some saying, well, I've got a lot of living to do before I come to him. Let me tell you, brother, you don't live until you come to him who said, I am come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And then I hear some praying, Lord, when I must go somewhere and crawl up in a dying bed and learn how to die, who told you were going anywhere else? Who told you're going to have the strength of a time to crawl up in a dying bed? And who told you were going to have to learn how to die? You learn how to live, dying's going to take care of itself. And as you live, so you die. But let me warn you, that borderline salvation is better than being lost, but that's too dangerous to risk. That's the reason the prophet said, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he's near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and he will have mercy. I know he'll have mercy. And to his God for you will abundantly pardon. I'm not going to wait for some far off distant day. Oh Lord, I'm saved, and I don't mind telling people I'm saved. I'm saved, and I'm sure about it. I'm saved, and I know it for myself. You don't have to tell me. I know I'm saved. Well, I didn't have to wait, Lord have mercy, until I found somebody who would recommend me. Lord, he just told me to believe on him, and I believed on him, and his grace saved me. Yeah, I'm so glad that I didn't have to go and get a long list of references. I came to Jesus as I was, weary, wounded, and sad. I found in him a resting place, and he has made me glad. I'm saved. Yes, I am. Yeah. And the first time I was getting ready to go overseas, and they told me I was going to have, in order to get a passport, I'd have to have a birth certificate. I don't know what was happening down in Robertson County in those days, but I know I didn't get a birth certificate. And they told me you were going to have to go from San Diego back down in Robertson County, Texas, and find somebody who knew your parents, and get them to swear out an affidavit that you were born. That confused me. There I stood 6 feet tall and weighed over 200 pounds. And when I open my mouth, you can hear me a half a mile. And I've got to go 1,800 miles to get somebody to swear an affidavit that I was born. But when I was born the second time, good God Almighty. Well, you know, that first time, I didn't know too much about it. When I knew anything, I was here. Look, I'm here. I didn't know what my name was. You know, I didn't know much to let them hang Shadrach Meshach on me. I didn't know my parents. They had to tell me who my father was and who my mother was. Well, I didn't know anything. Somebody had to tell me everything. But when I was born that second time, when I was saved, I tell others that I'm saved. Well, how you know, you say? For he's forgiven me of my past. Yes, he has. He's blotted out my past. He gives me power for the present, and he's given me a bright prospect for the future. Yes, I'm saved, and I know it. Good God Almighty. And I'm going to tell him, yes, he's my Lord. Now, he's going to be, but he is my Lord. Yes, I love the Lord because he's heard my cry. I'm going to trust him because of his wisdom. I love him because of his goodness. I praise him because of his greatness. I believe in him because of his faithfulness. I adore him because of his holiness. The Lord is my light and my salvation. The Lord is my strength. The Lord is my salvation. The Lord is my rock. The Lord is my fortress. The Lord is my high tower. The Lord is my deliverer. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Yeah. You know, this old world is a wilderness of want. We're always wanting something. If it isn't one thing, it's another. A man will break his health down trying to get wealth, and then turn around and spend his wealth trying to get his health back. You just can't keep life on an even keel. If your bank account gets low, then your blood pressure gets high. If you've got your health, if you've got money, your health breaks down. If you got a job, your eyesight gets dim. If you got food on your table, your faith gets weak. If it's not your enemies bothering you, it's your so-called friends. If it isn't your kinfolk mooching off of you, it's your church folk. And while you're building up over here, it's falling apart over there. But the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. A little girl was asked to recite this verse, and she said, "The Lord is my shepherd, and that's all I want." They said she was wrong. I said she's right. The Lord is my shepherd, and that's all I want. I shall not want for rest, for he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. I shall not want for refreshment, for he leadeth me beside the still waters. I shall not want for forgiveness, for he restoreth my soul. I shall not want for guidance, for he leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. I shall not want for companionship, for yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for thou art with me. I shall not want for comfort, for thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. I shall not want for provision or sustenance, for thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I shall not want for joy, for thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. I shall not want for anything in this life, for goodness is on one side and mercy is on the other, and they're going to follow me all the days of my life. And I shall not want for anything in the life to come, for I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I didn't say I'm going to tent or tabernacle or camp, but I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Dwell in a land where we'll never grow old. Dwell in a city that hath foundation, whose builder and maker is God. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Yes, he is mine. I'm so glad that he's mine. He's Lord. Yes. Whether you accept him as your Lord or not, he's still Lord. I'm so glad that he's not Lord by your vote. Good God Almighty. There was nobody before him, and there'll be nobody after him. He had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. You can't impeach him, and he's not going to resign. He's Lord. Yeah! Jesus Christ is Lord. Is he your Lord? Is he your Lord? He's Lord.